Kamusta naman po yung weight natin ngayon?
Long
time no si po. Hindi ko kayo nakita ng last week. Sa ngayon. Parang hindi ko kayo nakita.
So, wala.
Ay, what up pala yung wala? Patawarin. But, nandito na po ba yung lahat? Kompleto na po tayo. Paging po yung po mga artistahan natin, mga brothers and sisters sa labas. Please proceed na po sa atin.
Artistahin, ikaw talaga pumasok.
Kailangan talaga na sinasabi mo na artistahin para pumasok lahat. Yung ating worship service. So, ready na po ba yung lahat?
Yes!
Na makapanginig sa mensahe ni Lord for today?
Yes!
Pero kahit ganun po, masaya ako na nandito kayong lahat. Masaya po ba kayo nandito?
Amen!
Ako masaya po ako na nandito kayo, na nakakapag-ano tayo kayo, na may chance tayo para makapag-worship kay Lord, no? Kasi lahat po tayo nandito ngayon is napaka-super blessed kay Lord na nandito tayo ngayon, healthy tayo, na nasa mga mabuti tayong kalagayan, na yun lang po, yung napaka, yun lang po yung naano mo lang talaga kapag ka nag-a-attend po ako sa ating worship service, no? Na hindi lang yung comfort yung nag-feel ko pag nagpunta ko dito. Yun din yung naano mo na super na kapag may chance na nakakapunta ko dito, dun ko na-realize na yung lahat ng bagay na nabinigyan ako ng Lord ng chance para makapag-ano sa Kanya, makapag-worship sa Kanya, na hindi tulad po ng mga, unfortunately, yung mga brothers and sisters natin na gusto man nila na makapunta, which is may mga circumstances sila na pinagdadaanan ngayon na hindi po sila makapunta. Pero in ano naman po, God grace na maka-attend po sila in time. Marinig po natin, di ba? Mas dumami pa tayo next week.
Amen
po. And I would like to say hi po sa mga nanonood po dyan sa ating ano po, Google Meet. So let's start it po. Let's not forget our safety precautions since hindi pa din po nawawala yung COVID, no? So always wear our mask at all times and observe social distancing and always po maintain the cleanliness, no? So always bring a sanitizer kung saan man po tayo magpunta, no? Kasi hindi naman po natin masasabi ko yung mga kung ano yung mga nakakawakan natin yung pala yung ano, maging cause para ma-infected din tayo ng COVID. So, next. Ayan. So, what are we thankful for? Except for na nandito po tayo lahat ngayon na healthy at nakakapag-worship sa ating Lord. Anyone want to share po? Okay po, kung ano po, ito po yung mga ano natin for today, for our Thanksgiving. For our Thanksgiving po, okay, so lahat po ito for healing from COVID. Thanks be to God po for the healing of Sis Leonisa. Sis Hayden, Ave Angelo, Andrew Machito Nunez, Rowena, Mr. Arlan, Mrs. Beth, and Marlon, Rita, and Alfonina, Ali, Josephine, Riachi, Teresa, Lagrimas, and family members. And also to Sis Jacqueline, Jaden, Merlin, Robert, to family of Shirin and Vinces, Han Futura. And sa healing din po ni from cervical cancer po ni Sis Shelby, and sa healing din po from colds and flu ng Niriqua family. Thanks be to God. Sa atin, no, sa mga pinagdadaanan po natin, always yung Lord to the rescue sa atin, no? So, yan. For our tithes and offering, I just want to share this verse to you na sobrang na tumatak sa akin this week and this month, na nagpa-realize sa dahil sa situation or maybe sa situation na sino man sa inyo or makakamunit mo. I just want to share this one from the book of Matthew chapter 6 verse 31 to 33. Sabi ko, therefore do not worry saying, what shall we eat or what shall we drink or what shall we wear? For after all these things the Gentiles, for your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. But seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you. So, apakaganda po ng verse na ito. Na, for you, I just wanted to share this na, since I'm currently like, hindi naman in a unfortunate situation. Pero, I just want to ask this na, sa akin din, sa sabihin ko din na na-ask ko to this past week and this week also na, in the time of hardship or in a, like, in our financial crisis or any situation na, are we like, still too tight or to offer to our Lord? Yes po ba or no?
Yes.
Still, di ba? For me po, yes pa rin, di ba? Kahit na ano man circumstances yung napagdadaanan natin, kung mahirap man yan, or nasa magandang kinalagyan man tayo, still, dapat hindi tayo tumigil na magbalik kung ano yung ibinibigay sa atin ng Lord. Sabi nga mo, di ba, when we are fighting, at least the 10% we give to the Lord dun sa mga ibinibigay niya sa atin. Kasi kung in mathematical na anuman po, kung sabihin man natin na may 100 naman dyan, in 10% may ibibigay ka pa rin. Kung 50 man yan, at least 10% may ibibigay ka pa rin. Kaya kung wala man na, kung zero naman, percent, what's the percent of zero? It's still zero. So, doon, pwede na hindi ko nagbigay. Pero, kailan ba na hindi nagbigay sa'yo yung Lord sa mga needs mo? Diba? So, sa ano ko lang ngayon, situation na minsan, na sa mga financial crisis natin, just like na minsan, paano mo na, siyempre, pagdating na sa hold, nag-ano ka na, naka-budget na yan, na mapupunta na dito, mapupunta na dito, mapupunta na dito. And unfortunately for me, since I'm not expecting any salary for next month, and dun sa allowance na natira na lang sa akin, so, sabi ko, dito na ito mapupunta. Pero, paano na lang yung kay Lord? Yung ibibigay ko sa kanya, sabi ko, paano ko? Parang wala, sabi ko. And then, yun nga po, naano mo itong verse na to, na sabihin ka na, hindi naman nagkulang sa akin yung Lord na may kinakain pa naman ako, meron akong bahay na kumpilkan, at meron siyang mga tao na sinisend sa akin para pupunta sa akin. So, para yung ano na yun, hindi nagkulang pa rin sa akin yung Lord na kapakabuti na kita sa buhay ko. So, apaka-thankful ko kay Lord na sa mga times na feel ko na parang napaka-unfortunate ko ganon. Tapos meron din point marating din sa point na pag naiisip ko yun na ay parang nanineglect ko na kung ano yung mga dapat kong gawin para sa Lord, na minsan doon ako minsan na ano, wag na lang siguro muna ako pumunta ganun kasi wala akong maibibigay kasi minsan dumarating tayo sa point na ganun at di ba na kapag minsan naisip na kasi wala akong maibibigay kaya hindi na lang muna siguro ako pumunta ganun next time na lang kapag meron na which is dapat hindi. Hindi dapat mag-stop kung ano yung ginagawa mo sa Lord. Which is, kasi hindi din naman sa financial mo maibabalik yun eh, di ba? Pwede naman yung time mo, yung ibigay mo sa Kanya, at saka yung continuous prayer and faith, dapat hindi pa rin siya mawala. So, yun din yung na-realize ko na dapat, sabi nga mo dun sa last verse na, but seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you. So, yun lang po, kung from the time na may pinagdadaanan naman tayo, huwag tayo mawalan ng pag-asa or hope. Let's put our trust into our Lord na kaya niyang solusyonan yung lahat at mag-provide niya yung lahat ng mga lahat na bagay na tingin natin na kulang sa atin. Kasi siya lang din naman yung tunay na nakakaalam kung anong kailangan talaga na. So, yun lang po.
Ang ating puso na purihin siya at sabayin sa araw na ito. So sabi sa mga awit 51:10, isang pusong tapat sa akin ibigay. Binyan mo, O Diyos, ng bagong damdamin. Napakagandang verse po, kapatid, di ba? So, sabi natin, magdanas ka. Minsan siya sabi nila, people change. Sabi ko, oh bro, bago ka ng bro. Sabi ko sa kanya, kasi may nakapas niya parang bago. Pero, hindi naman natin alam kung ano yung pinagdala niya kung bakit siya nagbago. Siguro yung mga napagdala niya sa mga problema, siguro. Kaya sa mga nakakasama niya, kaya siya nagbago. Pero masasabi ko lang, mas masarap pagbago kung kasama natin ang Panginoon. At tingin natin sa kanya ang pusong dalisay. Ibibigay ng Panginoon niya, isa, suntin lang natin sila. Saka, wala na tayong ipaghanapin pa kung may problema ka, di ba? Yung parang, yung sa sarili mo parang walang-wala ka na. Sa Jeremiah 15:11, di ba sabi na? For I know the plans for you, may plano ang Diyos sa'yo. So, wala ka na dapat katakutan ng mga nangyayari dyan. May parang Diyos na nangyayari. Kung tunay na pag-ibig naman ang iyong hanapin, John 3:16 naman, for God so loved the world that He gave His begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him shall not be perished, but shall have everlasting life in heaven. Yun lang po. Ano pang hanapin natin? So, hilingin na natin sa Panginoon na yung damdamin natin ay maging dalisay your heart sa iyong Diyos. So, yun lang po. Let us pray po. Panginoon, maraming salamat po, Panginoon, sa araw-araw na bigyan mo po kami ng pagkakataon upang ikaw ay aming purihin, Lord God. Sana, Panginoon, ay bigyan mo po kami ng pusong dalisay sa iyo, Lord God. At pinapag-ako po namin, Lord God, na gagawin po namin ang mga rules mo, Lord God. Hindi ka namin susukayin, O God. Baguhin mo po kami, O God, sa araw na ito. Salamat po, Panginoon, at nandiyan ka lagi, O God, kahit na ganito kami, O God, na pakiramdam namin na hindi kami narapat-dapat. Pero nandito kami, O God, sa nandito kami sa harap mo, O God, upang gawin namin purihin, O God. Maraming po salamat, Panginoon. We claim victory po, O God, sa araw na ito. Christ Jesus, let me pray. This worship our living God. Tunay nga ang Diyos natin na ating tukurin at sasampay.
Pusong talisay ang aming nais. Yeah.
together?
All scripture is given by inspiration of God, and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for reprehension, for instruction in righteousness, that the mind of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work.
Good morning, Church. Sino po ito ang recently bumili ng cellphone na bago?
Dashi.
Maranti ko lang. Nung po inyong in-unbox yung bagong phone na yan, either iPhone yan or Samsung, kahit pa Oppo, Oppa, Vivo, ano pa yan? Meron bang kasama ng ano, printed na instruction manual?
Yes, yes.
Meron ba? Kasi yung, I think mostly wala na po. Ano? Wala na printed na ano, instruction manual.
Yung mga local.
Mga local. Because it says, i-download din na lang at meron mga QR code. They're going green, so wala nang printed na instruction manual. So, when you unbox that new phone, ang tendency is that, you know, yung mentality mo na, it's just an upgrade of my former phone, so I'm familiar with it. No need to go through the instruction manual. So, mag-unbox mo, charge mo na, use mo na agad yan, di ba? Ganun ang iyan, no? And it's like common to all. We grab it, we use it right away, and then when comes a time na hindi mo lang itong gagawin mo, meron certain kuman na you are lost, then you go back sa manual. Ganun, diba? Tsaka alam mo rin sa manual kapag hindi mo lang gagawin mo. This is the trend nowadays. We have that familiarity in our mind that when we have something, gamit agad. You know, there is a tendency sa mga, especially sa mga bagong mananampalataya, that when you get hold of that Bible, of that Word of God, or maybe even kahit sa dati ng mananampalataya, when you have a new Bible, you have that familiarity or assumption na, alam ko na yan, so buklat agad, gamit agad. Yeah. Then when you are stuck with some questions na hindi mo lang sagot, then you go back to the manual. Paano bang gamitin ng Bible? Paano bang i-trace or relocate yung issue na yon na ako'y naguguluhan? Or meron akong tanong na hindi ko alam ang sagot? That is our tendency. We only go back to the manual when we are lost or confused. Now our verse today, our study today is a very familiar verse that we have encountered this recently in our studies or preaching, which is what we have read a while ago. At nais ko pong talakayin ang mga bisikulo ito in the light of probably learning how to use the Bible with some guidance or some, I would say, tips. How to like go through the Bible in a more efficient way. Before that, tayo po manalangin. Father God, we thank you, Lord, for this morning that we gathered your children, Panginoon. At kagaya po ng aming pong inawit, Panginoon, may you open the eyes of our heart, Panginoon, upang kami po yung maging open sa iyong mga salita, Panginoon, maging kami po yung uhaw sa pagsalisip, Lord, yung salita, at gayon din, Lord, sa iyong will, sa iyong kalooban, kami po matanggap ang wisdom na nagmumula sa ito. Yung galitin, Lord, ang lingkod, at yung galitin din ng ang iglesia nito sa pagpalagana po ng iyong salita, Panginoon. We thank you, Lord God. Bless everyone, Panginoon. At maghari ka, Lord, sa lugar na ito. Protect this sa dila, Panginoon, na ang iyong holy na ito ang dalahin sa ngalan ni Jesus. Amen. Amen. So, ang ating pong title is, The Bible is the Indispensable Tool in Life. Yan po. Meron po kasing a significant change happening around us regarding some Christian believers. Na kung saan, it may be alarming kasi many are starting to claim as they read the whole Bible, they find or they kind of think that that is no longer the good book that they used to know. Kasi boy, the more that they study the Bible, lalong dumadami yung kanilang doubts, lalong dumadami yung kanilang pangagam-agam regarding the Bible. So, for some Christians who deconverted, dating hindi mananampalataya at naging mananampalataya, and then ngayon naging hindi uli mananampalataya, they have deconverted. So, what we call as the good book, the Bible, is no longer the same to them. If you go on social media, you will quickly see increasing number of videos made by former Christians who tell their stories of how reading the Bible turned them into either atheists or agnostics. So, the story generally goes that they grew up in churches and heard the usual nice stories in the Bible about Jesus healing the blind and Jesus teaching people to care about the poor. They heard the stories of amazing Bible heroes like the young David defeating who? Goliath? Yeah. And so the children's artwork in those children's Bible about the artwork depicting the story of Noah. Ang ganda ng picture doon. With smiling, happy animals in the ark floating on the water. Pero nangyari, as they got older and started reading the whole Bible with a new lens, bagong paningin, the Bible doesn't seem so wonderful and good anymore. Yung kanilang dating perception ng mga children's Bible ay nag-iba na. They realize that David is a polygamist with at least 8 wives. And also, maliban sa 8 wives, pero pa siyang concubines. And this is found in 1 Chronicles 3. This is on your screen. I will not highlight on this one, but this is on your screen. And I also encourage you in your own time, go through these verses more. And I think as we go through this sermon, you will realize that you really have to go back to these verses. They also read that he even killed 200 men and removed their foreskin as a bridal gift sa kanyang fiancé, yung father ng kanyang fiancé. Yan naman ay ayon sa 1 Samuel 18 verse 27. Imagine, siya ay namiligaw pala sa kanyang fiancé. For them, for the Jews, maybe out of their traditional culture, it is a good thing na pumatay ng kalaban at they will cut yung foreskin. Alam niyo yung foreskin, when a man is being circumcised, that part of the organ of man na pinuputol sa circumcision, ito yung iniipon nila sa bawat napatay nilang kalaban. Nakaipon siya ng 200. More than double what is required para po regalo sa kanya po magiging biyanan. That's what 1 Samuel 18:27 is talking about. In another scenario, this atheist, or the deconverted Christians, they begin processing that the nice children's story artwork they grew up upon with Noah on a boat with happy smiling animals floating on the water was a story of God causing massive death with the drowning of women, children, and infants. Also, their childhood children's storybook and artwork didn't show that Noah got drunk and passed out naked in his tent after God, when he got off the ark, which is on your screen. Yeah. It is also uncommon knowledge that, this is a third illustration, this is uncommon knowledge that slavery was talked about positively in the Bible, with people being sold as property and even instructions for a father selling his own daughter into slavery. What else is there? Panama. Bible verses from the Levitical laws with commands that God said not to eat shrimp or eat bacon or do not get tattoos. There is understandable question of why would God create rules that ban eating shrimps but would not ban slavery? Ganun yung mga klase ng question nila. There are repeated accusations that Christians cherry pick the verses they like and ignore the ones they don't like. Bible verses that seem so discriminatory, like when it says women should remain silent in the churches. We don't have that verse, but it's found in 1 Corinthians 14, 32-35. They are not allowed to speak, but must be in submission. It is disgraceful for a woman to speak in the church. So you see, this kind of extreme teachings found in the Bible, ito yung kanila nakita. Ito yung nagpabagsak sa kanila. That's why they were deconverted. Of course, it is them looking with their modern lens to this ancient word of God. So, the more the Bible is read, the more it certainly seems to be anti-women, it is anti-science, it is pro-slavery, it is pro-violence, based on what we have said. But my question is it true that the Bible, which is the good book, and if you really read it, you will find things you never knew before, and you will end up rejecting your faith? That's my question. Someone said, reading the Bible is the fast track to atheism. Now that's the scenario that we are looking at, that I'm raising. Now, but there are answers when we understand how to read the Bible, and when or how not to read the Bible. And this morning I just would like to maybe discuss around 7 tips how we can face this kind of situation, these scenarios. And I also understand that why this is happening, as for so many growing up in churches today, many of the very tough and disturbing things in the Bible were not address. So, seeing verses put to memes, iba ko sa mga memes sa social media, sa Facebook, they cannot ridicule the Word of God using memes. Or they mention in TikTok, of course, it becomes shocking to us and causes doubt and disbelief sa ibang tao. However, the Bible has responses to this. Well, we have to go straight away sa ating pong key verse, which is Second Timothy 3:16-17. I will read the whole verse. 2 Timothy 3:16-17. The Word of God says, all the Scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. Thanks be to God. And all Scripture is given by inspiration of God. Hindi naman tahakang sinabi ng Bible kung paano niya sinagawa yung paano yung true God's inspiration ay naisulat po ng maraming writer yung Word of God. But it literally means God breathed, kung saan nagsimula yung word na inspiration. So, it means God inspired the writers. It makes clear the ultimate source of the word is God Himself. On one side, they say that every thought and word were inspired by God, and that the writer did nothing but merely write as the Spirit dictated. Yung kabilang argument naman, in another view, that God gave the whole matter, leaving the inspired writers to their own language, to their own style, and hence the great variety of style and different modes of expression resulted in the end. So pareho naman tama, di ba? Pero yun yung ano yung argument ng mga ibang Bible scholars, which is like grouped into these two groups. And it goes on the verse saying, and is profitable for doctrine, to teach the will of God, and to point out Jesus Christ till He should come. For reproof. This is to convince men of the truth and to confound those who would deny it, particularly the Jews. The verse goes on saying, for correction. Correction means to restore things to their proper uses and places, and correcting false notions and those mistaken views. Ano ba? The Word of God continues saying, instruction in righteousness. It is to communicate all initiatory religious knowledge for schooling mankind. All this is perfectly true of the Jewish Scriptures. And let faith in Christ Jesus be added. Verse 17 goes on saying that the man of God, who is the preacher of righteousness, the minister of the gospel, the person who derives his commission from God, and always appears as his herald and servant. Yun yung tinutukoy na that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works, to fit or adapt. Perfect means, it's almost like saying an integer which is a whole figure or a whole number in arithmetic. Parang number one. It's a whole number. compared to 1/4, 1/2, 1/3 on 0.09, 0.08. No. This means all these toys will make the man of God perfect, complete, to which nothing needs to be added to make it complete. So with this simple description of these key verse, we find that while the Bible is 100% fully inspired by God, there are some Bible study methods we have to put into place to understand it and the difficult things in it, such as, ito na po yan, ating pong himayin. Number one, the top on our list is approach with humility. Well, I put this first because I think it's the most important thing we can do in reading the Bible. We should always approach the Bible with humility. And I think this is the most important tip about how to read the Bible. The Word of God says in Psalm 25, verse 9, He guides the humble in what is right and teaches them His way. We will often be tempted to approach the Bible to solidify and justify our positions. We come to this position wherein meron kang personal position. Now you are doubting, is it biblical? Ano nga gawin mo? You will approach the Word of God to figure out why you are right and they are wrong. This is called confirmation bias. You know, it's not helpful when reading the Bible. We establish our position in tithing, we establish our position in disciplining our children, and in word discipline. By what? By how? By cherry picking the verses. You will say, ah, this is my position because meron akong nakita biblical verse. One biblical verse to back up my position. And that's my purpose, my approach in reading the Bible. I want to justify na tama ang position ko and my neighbor is wrong. And I have the verse. That's confirmation bias. It's much like when you go to fish market, bibili ka ng crabs, gusto mo puro babae. Kasi alam mo yung mataba. Pupunta ka ng putasan. Mamimili ka ng watermelon. Lahat iba puncture mo. Kasi gusto mo makuha yung pula, yung matalis, di ba? Yun ang bibilin mo. That's cherry picking. In other places, you cannot do that. Or yung masisela, bibili ka ng 1 kilo rice, pipiliin ba yung putil? Para mabuo yung 1 kilo? That's extreme, huh? Actually, it is dangerous and it's very dangerous really, and it completely misses the point of why the Bible exists. The Bible does not exist so that you have proof verses for all your positions. The Bible does not exist to prove that they are in the wrong and you are right. The Bible's primary job on your screen is not even to give you all the answers. True, sometimes you will not get the answer of your position. Why? Because the Bible does something much greater. And the Bible's purpose is to transform you. Okay? There is a quote from N.T. Wright, which is displayed on your screen, and this is read as, we read scripture in order to be refreshed in our memory and understanding of the story within which we ourselves are actors, to be reminded where it has come from and where it is going to, and hence what our own part within it ought to be. Maganda yung kanyang ano, nabanggit dito. Na ayon sa kanyang sinabi, siguro, if I interpret it right, na kapag binasa mo ang scripture daw, ay parang you can relate, you can refresh sa iyong buhay, sa iyong diwa, yung understanding ng story na ikaw ay bahagi noon. Na kung saan, meron kang palang kalalagyan doon sa story na yun. And this story will guide you kung saan yung kanyang pinanggalingan at alin yung kanyang role ngayon at yung ating inaasahan in the future. So there is a story na kung saan bahagi tayo nito. That's why the Word of God is buhay. This is the living Word, di ba? Meron tayong pwedeng makuha ano rito. Anything. Application, meron tayong room na pwedeng gampanan dyan. Within that story, meron tayong ginagampanan. And that's magiging relevant when you dig the Word of God. Meron palang design ng Panginoon na ikaw ay bahagi ng istorya niyo. If we don't approach the Bible with humility, we will be tempted to place ourselves at the center of that story. So with that story, kapag hindi mo siya in-approach with humility, ang gusto mo ikaw yung leading actor. Why we are right and they are wrong. Humility reminds us that God is the center of this story. And He has invited us to play a role in His story. So the Bible seeks to transform you and invite you to a better story. But that can only happen when we approach it with humility. So, this is the first thing. Reading the Bible starts with humility. That humble heart. That submissive heart.
Ayaw ko malaro. Naghahanap ko
The Bible is a library, not a sole book. Amen? So when opening a Bible or reading it digitally, we don't read it like a normal book. It is a library of how many books? 66 books. Written over 1,600 years. In a span of 40 generations, merong at least 40 na authors from every walk of life. And it is done in different genres. Done in three continents, Asia, Africa, and Europe. And the three languages were Aramaic, Hebrew, and Greek. And by now, there are at least 700 translations of the Bible. The Bible is unique in its teachings. It is a book of law, poetry, letters, prophecy, history, and personalities with subject matter involving hundreds of controversial topics. Yet, despite of all this complexity, it is consistent. And there is connection, there is harmony, there is continuity. So when you open the Bible, it is like going into a library na kung saan you will pull off from a shelf, and depending on what section of the library you are in, you read it differently. If you're reading a book of poetry, which is, for example, Proverbs, it will be read differently than when reading a book of history, like when you open a book of Judges. Or when you read a law book that has laws pertaining to certain people at certain times and places, the laws may or may not apply to us in our world. This is on your screen, a table showing the genres of the Bible, wherein it's grouped, like simplified in at least these columns: law, history, prophecy, gospel, letters, and this wisdom or poetry. It groups the different books of the Bible in these different genres. And we said it's like a library, it's not a sole book. So when you pick up a certain book, you look at it in a different way. The book of Acts recounts historical events as chronicled by a historian. Saan sa nakita yung book of Acts? Saan po?
History.
History book, ano? The book of Acts? It's here. It is written by or chronicled in a historical fashion by a historian. The book of Psalms uses exaggeratory language to express emotion. Diba? The Gospels are... What are the Gospels? Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Revelations. These are eyewitness accounts of Jesus' life, Jesus' death, and Jesus' resurrection. The Ephesians, for example, is a letter written to the people of Ephesus. So, each one of these books need to be read within their genre. So, it is displayed on your screen. So, now we can see how wonderfully God has written the book. It's not a sole book, it is actually a library. Number three. Take note of this. Never read a Bible verse pulling out a single Bible verse on their own. One can make the Bible say almost anything. Di ba, napansin nyo, karamihan ng debate, mga biblical or spiritual debate, ay laging ganyan. They pick up a certain single line verse at pag-uusapan ng ilang generation without really going deep into the context. So, never read a Bible verse without understanding the context of that verse. You always need to read the full context of what is happening, not just looking on a single verse. So you don't pull a single sentence from the fiction, halimbawa, The Lord of the Rings. And then out of that single statement, you can make a conclusion of the movie. No. You have to place it in the whole story. Well, of course, the Bible is not fiction, but the same principle applies. every verse is part of a specific section of the whole story, we need to examine to make sense of the verse. Don't rely on stating just one verse. Understand the context. Number four. The Bible was not written to us, but for us. Some parts of the Bible are written to everyone, and some parts were written to specific people at a specific time for a specific purpose. Well, we all know it is all 100% inspired by God and for us to learn from. Yun po ating alam. It is all inspired by God. And we have established that. But we must look at each part of the Bible from the eyes and culture of the original reader and why and what God was trying to communicate to them. Ganun po ang dapat approach sa pagbabasa ng Bible. So the statement goes, the Bible was not written to us, but for us. Amen. Number five. Number five will be a bit longer discussion than the others, which says, consider the context. Kung inyo kung ignore ang context of the Bible, you can quite literally make it say anything you want out of that single verse. But this is not just a biblical principle. This is just true in life. This is also true in life. Amen? Hindi lang pwede isang biblical principle na to look at the context. It applies in life. When you are reading a book, an article, or listening to a podcast, or watching an interview, you must view what is said and written in context of the surrounding text. Otherwise, you will end up with something that was not intended. And this is dangerous. We do this all the time. Some people do this all the time. Especially in social media, daming fake news, ang daming kumakalat ng memes, kung ano na lang, they pick up something. The social media is full of people taking one sentence out of an interview and then they will blog a post or a video and using it to insinuate something completely different than the original intended meaning. Some people wanted to showcase something with juicy heading. Well, yeah. Kailangan yung heading juicy, kailangan catchy. Pag nag-state ng isang phrase or sentence, it is a very strong statement na katas ng attention. And it is terribly damaging practice. We should not do this practice. Well, yung mga tabloids or some newspapers, they do that. Just in order to catch your attention. Parang sa shopping din. Yung impulse buying, ganun, di ba? There is, sa isang store, may naka-display doon na something na eye-catching. Pero pag pasok mo ng shop, yun lang pala yung isang magandang dami. The rest, hindi. So parang ganun din. When you, like, scroll in your social media, oh, it's ganda ng heading. But when you read through it, iba yung laman ng story. So, this is dangerous. We must consider the context. How to read the Bible effectively means we cannot ignore the context. Context matters. When we are reading the Bible, we cannot ignore the context in which we are, in which what we are reading is written in. Nice po magbigay sa inyo example for discussion. And we will use this verse from Matthew 18:20. Ano po sabi ng verse? For where two or three gather in my name, there am I with them. Familiar verse?
Amen.
Amen. familiar, especially sa prayer meeting. If all you ever read was this verse, one would think that Jesus is saying that God is there when there is a group of Christian believers that are gathered. That's how you probably heard this verse applied in most churches. But you know, that's not what Jesus is talking about in this verse. If you look at the whole narrative, right? The surrounding verse of Matthew 18 tell a much different story. Ano sabi nito? Jesus is actually giving instructions on what to do when people have conflict with another person. Diba? So, context matters. If we ignore it, we will likely come away with the wrong and sometimes damaging interpretation of the Bible. Context is king. One cannot ignore it. Here's what that means. Look at the surrounding verses and look at the larger narrative of the Bible and consider the original audience. You see, when we're doing a Bible study, diba, si Pastor Edmer madalas magtanong, sino yung writer? Saan niya yung sinulat? Nasaan sila? Ano yung condition ng time na yon? Ano yung umiiral na law ng time na yon? Diba? So you look at the larger narrative of the Bible and you consider the original audience. Look at the surrounding verses. Ito yung sumunod. The solution is often simple. Just read the surrounding verses. When you read a verse, compare it to what is said prior and what is said after. Yeah? Doing that will help you discern what the Bible is really saying. So, spend extra time. Unawain niyo po, kung meron may class sa inyo magandang verse, wow, magandang verse. Gusto niyo yung Bible niyo, balikan niyo yung verses before that and yung mga succeeding verses pa. Then we will see a whole picture, di ba? It's much like yung crossword puzzle. When you pick up one piece ng crossword puzzle, wow, ganda. Parang it describes everything. Yung part na yun, may mukha. May part ng mukha. But you don't see the whole picture ng puzzle. And that puzzle is 1,000 pieces. Di ba, Irene? You need to see the larger narrative of the story. Then you will make up, hindi lang pala isang mukha yung picture na yan, yung portrait na yan. But it's a community. I don't know. But see, doing that will help you discern what the Bible is really saying. Look at the larger narrative of the Bible. The larger picture of reading the Bible is, in context is looking at how the passage you are reading compares to the larger narrative. How does this verse I'm reading now compare to what is said elsewhere? We all know also that the Bible is the inerrant word of God. There is no conflict in the Bible. So, when you are stuck in that position, this verse is having conflict, right? But it will not end there. You try to understand the context and the narrative of the Bible. Then that verse will make sense. If it contradicts another verse, there is a good chance that we interpreted that verse in the wrong way. Consider the original audience. The Bible was written for you, but it was not written to you. Each book of the Bible was written to a specific group of people in a specific time. We have to understand that culture and the people before we can fully understand what the Bible, the meaning of the text is. So we have to understand the original audience before we can land on what specific verses actually mean to us. There is truth in this verse, but the truth is found when we view the verses within the cultural context. Two easy ways to do this. Of course, we recommend is for you to buy a Bible. Buy a good Bible. And then, check out a commentary. It is important to have a Bible. It is important also, as we always encourage you, to invest on a good Bible. Sometimes, you know, when we decide on buying a Bible, we make it a criteria that I'm the smallest possible size, bucket size, para madaling ibulsa, idaling ibag. That's, maybe it's practical, but try to have that bigger Bible na meron ding mga commentaries. At hindi po kayo, malulugi in this investment. It is worth investing on your Bible. So, how to read the Bible means that we have to pay attention to the context in which the Bible is written. Number six, all the Bible points to Jesus. From the very opening of the Bible to the very end, it all leads and points to Jesus. When we see this, it all lines up to an amazing, beautiful, life-changing library of books. The Word of God says in John 1:1-2 says, the Word became flesh. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. We should realize that all the Bible, although it's comprised of 66 books, it points to Jesus. It is really sad seeing so many who are losing faith in the inspired Word of God, isn't it? You know, I became a Christian at 22. Though my journey of knowing the Bible is gradual, but it changed my life. And I believe it can change so many others. It can change their lives too. There are answers when we search more deeply and understand it is an ancient text. Listen to this. The Word of God may be an ancient text that we cannot just read with our modern eyes. Tama niyo po? Yung ating kultura ngayon, yung ating pananaw, yung ating modern eyes, it will not match an ancient book. But we have to look at it more thoroughly. So my prayer is that parents and churches will teach early on about the difficult parts so it does not catch people off guard and when they haven't seen them before. We are now moving to number seven. This could be an application. Ask questions. The first six steps on how to read the Bible is centered around getting a proper understanding of what the Bible is saying to us. This focus on proper exegesis. Exegesis is reading to get the intended meaning of out of the passages that we are reading. That's the meaning of exegesis. Reading to get the intended meaning out of the passages that we are reading. So, these next two tips are applications of the text. How do we apply what we know to our lives? The first step is to ask questions. Be curious. Yeah, there's nothing wrong with asking questions. Be curious. Think of yourself as a journalist that is investigating the passage. This could be some typical questions that you can raise when going through the Word of God. Here's some questions I'd like to ask. What does the passage teach me about God? It could be your first question. Then, what does this passage teach me about humans? Your first question is about God. Second question is about humans. In light of this, what is this passage trying to teach me? What do I need to do? That's your third question, possibly. And then, maybe lastly, you can ask, what does this passage teach me about how I relate to others? Then you have a purpose in reading the Word of God. Because these are the things that you want to ask and you want to find answer, right? Well, really you don't have to ask these questions. You might be more interested in why this verb is used or what the original audience was struggling with at the time of writing. Meron laging dahilan kung bakit naisulat yun nung panahon na yun, nung culture na yun, nung certain era na yun. The point is to just be curious about why this passage is in the Bible. Let's take, for instance, our earlier discussion about polygamy. I would like to take one issue using this kind of questioning. Shall we do that? Let's talk about polygamy. About what we had mentioned earlier about David and Solomon. And let us test yung question na to, how we can apply in this issue. The first question, what does the passage 1 Chronicles teach me about God? Well, the Bible does not specifically say why God allowed polygamy. But one thing is clear. You talk about God, God did not change His moral law, which included plural covenantal marriages. Multiple partners is the way of the world. Ito ay mga mundo. But not God's way. This is what we learn of God. It is not condoned in the world. Polygamy is not condoned in the Word of God. And it causes dissension. That's what we find out about God. Second question. What does this passage teach me about humans? Well, the issue of polygamy, let's look at the position of man. Man, sa kasamaan, in a sad note, man has drifted away from God's truth. Ito ang nature ng tao. He has drifted away from God's truth. And this verse reveals man's stubborn heart. Polygamy caused strife in the lives of those men in the Bible. The biblical authors never comment the polygamies in the Old Testament. Instead, they are often at pains to show the devastating consequences of deviating from God's established pattern of monogamy. God also forbade the kings of Israel to have many wives. Diba? According to Deuteronomy 17:17, ano sabi rito? Neither shall he multiply wives to himself, that his heart turn not away. Neither shall he greatly multiply to himself silver and gold. The Word of God is not condoning polygamy. So look at the trouble when Israel's kings disobeyed, including deadly sibling rivalry between David's sons from his different wives. In 2 Samuel 13 and 1 Kings 2, ano sabi rito? Amnon and Tamar, Absalom kills Amnon. And in 1 Kings 2, David's charge to Solomon, Solomon's throne established. Well, this is a long version, so 1 Kings 2. But yung kanilang disobedience from God's word ay nagdulot po ng pagdurusa sa kanilang buhay. And it has consequences. At yung pong case ni Solomon, having 700 wives and 300 concubines, this practice actually led Solomon to idolatry. Diba? One of her wives ay nagdala ng problema na yun. Then, you ask me, why did God allow it? Bakit ba nalaw ng Diyos yung ganyan mga senaryo, yung polygamy? And why this is the case of those people na ginawa ng Diyos na example na gagawa ng kanyang will? God's permitting of polygamy seems more like the case of divorce, which God tolerated for a while under certain conditions because of the hardness of their hearts. Yung divorce ay meron ding pagkakahalintulad doon sa polygamy na at some point inalaw ng Panginoon because of the hardness of their hearts. But it was not the way it was intended from the beginning. Ayon sa Matthew 19, verse 8. Whenever the Mosaic Law had provisions for polygamy, it was always the situational or conditional. You see, when the lawmakers are putting up a law, they are putting all the conditions, all the situations, all the conditions that could possibly arise. Di ba? Halimbawa, sa case na to, ang pinag-usapan yung law ng polygamy. So, it was conditional. Yung laging merong if na scenario. If, it's conditional, it's situational. If he takes another wife to himself, God is not saying he should take another wife to himself. Pero sabi ng law, gumagawa ng law. Sabi niya, kayo na mga judge, ito ang guide ninyo, itong law. Ano yung isang scenario? If that good man takes another wife to himself, ito yung consequences. So you see, God is putting up these rules, this law. And it's not making more pleasant to that person. It's not making it more easy. Di ba? Kung meron ganong provision, merong kaakibat yun na mas mabigat na responsibility. Why? For example, dito, yung mga tao rito, they can marry at least 4. Kung yung unang asawa ay di magkaanak, they have the ground to have the second. At having the second comes with more responsibility. Kung paano mo i-treat yung una, kailangan ganun din sa pangalawa. So, it doesn't come easy doon sa tao. Now, if you look at the background of Solomon, if you look at the Bible, is so rich. Rich. Napakayaman niya. 700 wives, easy. Kaya. Yung rights ng isa, kaya ibigay sa iba. Kaya lang, yun nga, it doesn't come easy. Because meron ganung provision. If he takes another wife to himself, it was a law. Now, among Israel's patriarchs and kings, the accounts of polygamy in their lives cast a shadow on this departure from God's design and definition. Of course, God's design is monogamy, di ba? Isang asawa. Polygamy is departing from this rule. Now, apart from monogamy, ito na pasok yung polygamy, then, saan katerbang situation? Saan katerbang requirements? And that is what the judges are using to judge that kind of person. Kung siya nag-asawa ulit at hindi naman niya ma-afford, then he is liable to the law. Diba? Kung hindi niya matreat yung pangalawang asawa, the way what the law requires, it's a problem. Now, the spiritual and familial devastation on display in Scripture invites us to see the beauty of monogamous marriage. climaxing in the union of Christ and His bride. What does this passage teach me about how I relate to others? This was the verse kanina. In the light of this, what this passage teaches, what do I need to do? So, at itinabagin kanina, the biblical authors include their stories not to inspire their readers, but to warn them. When the Bible does encourage Christians to imitate Old Testament saints, it never does so without exemption. So you see, plenty of Old Testament figures like David and Solomon held out as negative examples. Would you think they are positive examples? No, they are negative examples. Sa aspect na to, yung living a righteous life, yung righteous behaviors, no, they are negative examples. But furthermore, the New Testament most often upholds the faith of Old Testament saints as the primary feature worthy of attention and emulation. Kung meron man character, for example, si David or Solomon, sa area ng righteous behavior, they are not good example. But in the area of faith, sila ay worthy of emulation. Sila ay worthy of that attention. So, you see, when God explained this, when God explained about their behavior, about their lives, it's all about failure, di ba? It's all about failing to meet the law. But these people, in the area of faith, they excel. They fulfill what God intended them to do. Anong tinuturo ito? Well, this is teaching us the stubbornness of man. Napakahabang panahon, in the Old Testament, ang dami sinubo. They failed in the area of obedience. They cannot save themselves. They cannot fulfill the law. But in the area of faith, in the area of fulfilling the Word of God, they submitted to God. Amen? So these people, meron tayong tututunan sa kanila. But you must relate back sa kanilang panahon. Sa kanilang panahon na kung saan, sa Jews, it is an honor to kill an enemy. Kaya kanina, we said, kung nakakapure siya ng 100 na enemy at kinuha yung foreskin, isinabihin doon sa kanilang elders, sa kanilang ano, it is an accomplishment. Iba yung culture nung time na yun. Sa ating panahon ngayon, we don't do that. Di ba? You don't go into war, and when you conquer your enemies, you will cut their foreskin and collect them all. This is really important. Looking at the context, looking at the situation at that time, when God was putting up all the laws, you see, it's a good guideline. In fact, it comes basic. Whenever lawmakers put up something, they consider all the possibilities, all the conditions, all the situations. So you will find it there. When you talk about, when you read the book of the laws, it states so many things. If this happens, if this man failed in that area, ito yung katapat. Diba? So in the same way, when you take it up to another subject, which is maybe slavery, bakit yung slavery nung time na yun masyado rin, ano, parang kinukondol parang salita ng Diyos? Actually, it's not. You know, in those times, just to give a little bit of discussion or background, na kung saan, countries are into war. So, marami pong fatality. At yung kultura noon, yung mga babae, they are silent. and they only end up as wives, and not all of them are having husbands. They rely on their brothers or sisters or brothers or father to support them. So kung isang babae ay hindi makapag-asawa, she might end up into prostitution or something else. Kawawa siya. Kaya, nung time na yun, parang it is a favor pa na kung saan maging second wife, third wife, or sa case ni Solomon, 700 wife. Kasi masisecure na yung kanyang needs. Magkakaroon siya ng self-shelter, she will be fed, she will have what she needs to survive. Kasi yung mapabayaan siya or mag-end up into prostitution. Gayun din yung mga concubinates. They will be taken care of by someone, for example, Solomon, who was able to meet those criteria in the law. So, meron mga dahilan na lang. So, na-meet yung law, na-protect yung babae, at kung titingnan mo sa mga laws about slavery, ganun din, if yung tatay ibibenta yung anak na babae into slavery, nakita niyo, meron ganung condition. They are laws, but God does not condone them. But God is making the law looking at the hardness of the heart of man. Natukoy niyo po yung point ko. God sees man as matigas ang ulo. Okay, how do we deal with this problem? If you do that, ito yung consequences. If you do this again, ito na naman yung more consequences. If you fail that, then you are liable to the law. That's why there are so many laws at that time. And there are so many laws because when the law came, it shows how bad the heart of man is. Diba? The more the law na nagawa, the more na mas maraming situation, mas maraming condition na kailangan ma-meet. And that's how wise God is. It doesn't mean it was written that God condones those things. But they were happening in those times, and God has to deal with it. So, yun lang po, konting discussion about those issues. And my point is, going through the verses by them alone will not give you the answer, will not give you the right information. You have to analyze the bigger picture, the bigger narrative of the story. Now, another application is to relate and meditate. We often view the Bible as something on our to-do list. Parang, okay, it's nice to have a reading plan of the Bible. You read one chapter, you tick, done. Pero mas magiging makabuluhan po to reflect on and meditate on what you are reading. Try to see, wag lang yung ano, yung basta for the sake na nabasa mo lang siya. But after you have done all the hard work of reading, it's time to reflect and meditate on what you have read. It's time to let the words soak into our lives and begin the transformation process. So then, brothers and sisters, don't let the words you just read fade in your memory. Think about them. Pray about them. And come back to it throughout your free time. Write a verse out and place it in your mirror. Journal about what you have read. Reflect on what you just read. Diba? Napakaganda ng ano? It doesn't stop there. Na kung meron kang nabasa na, okay, parang stock knowledge. No. The Word of God has a purpose on you. You have to meditate on it and reflect on it, how this ancient text can apply in my modern life. Yeah? Conclusion. This is a short conclusion. So, remember, the Bible is there to transform you. that will not happen if you just check it off your list and move on. Because kanina, it will not happen. You will not be transformed. Kung just for the sake of reading, sabihin mo, I've gone through the Bible 3 times from cover to cover. Just for the sake of digging by books. No. What's more important is you meditate on it and reflect on it. How to read the Bible effectively means that we let it soak into our lives. You have to see that picture kanina, yung ating kinol from N.T. Wright, that you are an actor in the big story. Yeah? But don't make yourself as the center of the story. You are playing a role in that story wherein Jesus is the center of that story. At ikaw ay bahagi ng play na yun. Diba? So, if you happen to read about slavery, if you happen to look at the subject of giving or Christian ethics, or maybe you are looking into the commitment in the ministries and about another sensational issue kanina, yung role ng women sa church, or you want to go back to the story of Noah in that great deluge, you want to soak into your obedience to God. You know, in any of those discussions or any of those topics, we need the right approach in reading the Bible. We need to establish that humility, the low hearted approach to the Bible, with taking away pride and submitting to the will of God. We also need to understand the full context of what we are reading, and we need to ponder upon these verses with questions that will arise your curiosity, questions that will like bring some exercise in your mind to have that hunger to search more. So after that, now try to reflect and meditate upon them with a prayerful heart. We always need to be prayerful, asking God for wisdom and guidance. So, the Bible is every Christian's indispensable tool in life. You cannot avoid it. You cannot live without it. The Bible is your indispensable tool in life. So, understanding how to use this tool will make it more effective, you know, more efficient. And it's worthy of the time and effort. And it will keep you in track of being a believer of our Lord Jesus Christ. You need to do that para hindi ka maging deconvert. Diba? Ikaw na na-convert, you should remain a Christian by constantly looking upon the Word of God and communicating to God. Don't let that situation come in your life na sobrang laki na yung doubt mo and you will just resort, ay, meron palang ganung word eh, yung atheist. Kapag tinatang yung wala, doon na lang ako. No. I encourage you, brothers and sisters, to enrich your knowledge, to dwell upon the Word of God, so we remain faithful to Christ. The wrong uses and the misinterpretations of the Word leads to derailment and catastrophic consequences. We have seen the lives of these great men. Yes, they have power, they have the money, the riches. Because of that, they were able to afford those many wives, but did not give them happiness. It cost them a lot of problems. Solomon, in the end, hindi naman siya masaya, di ba? In your studies about Solomon, Solomon is the person who would say, all this is in vain. Everything, yung riches, yung maraming asawa, wala, walang kwenta lahat. walang kwenta lang. God is the source of wisdom. So we should avoid these catastrophic consequences by knowing how to approach the Bible. Ilan po, to God be the glory.
Thank you, Pastor Ronnie, for delivering to us today the Word of God. Let us all rise and prepare our hearts to sing our victory song in response. Truly, the Word of God is the foundation we need to keep feeding ourselves with, so we can continue to learn the right way on how to live the way God wants us to live. And as we sing this together, let this be our prayer that we look to the Word of God not as a storybook, but as a lamp unto our feet to guide us in our way.
In particular, but whenever you may raise it up, or otherwise, you can pray your personal prayers as we pray along. And, sometimes there are prayers that we don't want to disclose. We find it too personal, but God knows our needs and our situation. If you can raise it up with a prayer partner, we'll get the info. At this point, we will also be raising some other concerns which may be under the care of the pastor's office. And then later on, we will end up with the benediction. So, nawa yun pong ating, I would call it like a basic teaching today about approaching the Word of God, or tips in reading the Word of God may instill something in you na mag-inspire sa inyo to go through the Word of God. Because sometimes we are overwhelmed by the fact that the Bible is comprised of so many genres or stories that are appearing to be so complex. Well, we cannot actually do it on our own, so we need to pray about it. And we need to invest time on it to look through the Word, to have some understanding about it. And also, ang pagiging Kristiyano po is a journey na kung saan every step that you take is guaranteed po sa Word of God. Every page that you go through ay nagiging bahagi po na inyong lakad. So, it may be ambitious to some to learn the Word of God in a short span of time, but what's important is to read the Word of God and meditate upon it and see how it will soak in your life and how your life can play that a role in that beautiful story of the Word of God. So with that, let's pray po. And thank you for your time and thank you for being with us today. Ngayon po sa ating mga kapatid online, we praise God for this opportunity to gather. At let us pray. Father God, we thank you, Lord, for this day that you gathered your church in worship, in spirit, and in truth. We come to you, Lord God, also with our praises and thanksgiving. And may you find our singing of hymns and praises as a fragrant offering to your kingdom, my Lord. At sa kung ano po ang aming pagkukulat, may you seek our hearts, search us, O Lord, and forgive us of our sins. And may you restore that fellowship between you and your church, my Lord, especially here in the GICM Dubai. We thank you, Lord God, for this villa that you have given us so that we are able to gather and to conduct our worship service. We continue to pray for your protection for this villa, Panginoon. May your holy blood fill the four corners of this property, Panginoon. Maging malaya po sa tangka ng kalaban, Panginoon. Subalit kami magawa ng freedom to worship you as a body, Panginoon. May you protect this place from the threat of COVID-19 and some other diseases, Panginoon. At gayon din, most importantly, sa disease card na maaaring ma-infect sa aming heart, Panginoon. We cast away all the works of the enemies. We declare, Father God, you are reigning in this church, in this place, sa puso ng bawat na napatay, Panginoon, at sa kanilang mahal sa buhay, mga pamilya, Panginoon. We know that each one of the brethren here will be instruments, will be channel of your blessings to their households, to their family, Panginoon, sa kanilang area of influence, Father God, maybe sa kanilang workplace, at sa mga lugar na kanila pong ginagalaw. Lord God, makita ang Kristo na nagkahari sa buhay ng bawat sa Panginoon, at ngayon din, makita ang kaibahan, Panginoon, ng buhay ng mananampalataya sa hindi, Panginoon. Give us that consciousness and the gracious heart to reach out to the unbelievers, Panginoon, so that we are able to declare your mercy, your glory, and your gospel, Panginoon. At kayo, nawa, Panginoon, ang dalangin ay kuminister sa kanilang buhay sa parandor na kayo na pumakahagawa. Lord God, we acknowledge you as our great healer. We come before you with many petitions about health conditions of our friends, family, and brethren, Panginoon. Maray po ngayon infected ng COVID. For some, maybe a minor symptoms. For some, maybe mild or severe, Panginoon. Ang aming dalangin, ang iyong kagalingan, ang iyong pag-iingat, at ang iyong restoration, Lord, ang kamusulat po ng bawat isa. At sa mga walang karamdaman, Lord, aming dalangin ang iyong protection. Aming dalangin din ang iyong pag-iingat sa pamatawan, Lord, ng bawat isa. Sa mga merong karamdaman, Lord, who are in financial needs, may you provide for them, Father God, na kanilang mabit ang kanilang financial needs so that they will also get the medical attention that they need, Panginoon. May it be here, may it be with our loved ones elsewhere, Panginoon. Ito po ang dalangin, Lord, God, sa mga may karamdaman. At sabi po, kapatid, like MJ, who is tested positive, Panginoon, and in quarantine, Brother Mike, and for others whom we may not be fully aware of their condition, Lord, may you restore them fully, Father God, sa nagalingan na nagmumula sa iyo, Panginoon, ng mga ayos na makasama next time, Panginoon. And for those who are completing their quarantine, be with them, Father God, and continue to protect them and give them the assurance na kayo po ang Diyos na nagbibigay po ng lunas at kagalingan. At sa ibang karamdaman, Lord God, that we all know, we raise them every prayer meeting, Panginoon. Aming pong pinapangalawahan, Panginoon, ang mga dalangin na kalista doon, Panginoon, with our family, friends, and loved ones, Panginoon, and those who are among us na meron din karamdaman, Lord God. Aming dalangin po ang iyong mapagpalang kamay. We know that your mercy ay malawak, Panginoon. Aming pong dalangin na dami niyo pang dagdagan, Lord God, ang iyong habag sa iyong mga anak, Lord God. We pray for our country, our leaders back home, our communities, and the society around us, Panginoon. We pray sa iyong patuloy na pag-iingat sa maraming tangka, Panginoon, from the economy, from the health of the society, from the issues that we are facing right now, Panginoon, ang election sa Pilipinas, ang pagbangon po ng ekonomiya, ang pagkapalit po ng administration, Panginoon. All this, Father God, aming pong grandas sa iyo. Ang aming mga mahal sa buhay na who may be in a difficult situation due to the pandemic, Lord God, with their economic condition, their livelihood, their jobs, their condition, oh Lord God, that right now we pray that you will lift them up, Father God, in a special way na kanila makita na kayo po ay buhay, kayo po ay umutugan, Lord, sa mga dalangin. Sa mga dalangin, Lord God, namin pong iglesia, about spiritual growth, about the edification, Lord, of the saints, yung mga mananampalataya, mga leaders sa amin ng iglesia, Panginoon, mga deacons and mga admins, at sa iba't ibang ministries, Lord God, sa GAM, sa UPM, sa transport ministries, sa men's, sa women's, sa aming mga singles, Panginoon, sa mga kabataan, Lord God, and for the education of everyone, for the teaching, for the rebuking of the brethren who may be lost. We all seek your mercy, we all seek your will, Panginoon, sa iyong pong church. Right now, GICM Dubai, and also GICM Aspen, and share na Panginoon, at saan po ng aming mamahal sa buhay. Lord God, kumilos ka sa puso ng bawat isa upang kami rin ay lalo mag-init sa area po ng evangelism, Panginoon. Sa area po ng obedience, allow us to grow as well, Father God, and in our commitment into your ministries. At aming mga may bahay, Panginoon, aming mga magulang, aming mga anak, aming kapatiran, yung i-bless, Panginoon, sa paraan na kayo lang po makakagawa, Panginoon. We praise you, Father God, you are faithful to us, you are always there, and you never fail in your promises, Lord God. Lord, allow us and teach us to adhere to your word. Allow us to be possessor of that wisdom that comes from you, Father God. Lord, give us that enlightenment that whenever we seek your word, give us that direction, Father God. Lord, pagpalaan yung kesa nito, pagpalaan yung gawain, Panginoon, sa po ng aming mga kapatid na online, be with them, Father God. At sa mga kapatid, Lord God, who are not with us today, bless them, O Lord God, in a special way na kanilang makita ang iyong call sa kanilang buhay, Panginoon. Lord God, salamat po muli sa gawain nito at pagpalaan yung mga kapatid sa kanilang, Lord God. At tunay, Ama, we praise you and glorify your name. To God be the glory. Kung kami dalangin sa pangalan ni Jesus. Amen. At this point po, tayo po tumanggap po ng blessings through God's word. This is the benediction. According to the word of God, it says, may the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, equip you with everything good for doing his will. And may he work in us what is pleasing to him. Through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen.